Dear students, today we shall be talking about the general characteristic features of the phylum Echinoderma. So before proceeding on, it is my request to you all to like and subscribe my channel BioLearnia. When we try to define these echinoderms, we define them as the organisms which are anterocoelous coelomates with pentamerous radial symmetry. They don't have a distinct head or a brain. They are having a calcareous endoskeleton which is made up of separate plates or pieces, and they are having a peculiar water vascular system of coelomic origin. They are having the podia or tube feet which project out of the body. So when we try to define these echinoderms, they are defined as the anterocoelous coelomates with pentamerous radial symmetry, without distinct head or brain, having calcareous endoskeleton of separate plates or pieces, having peculiar water vascular system of coelomic origin, and podia or tube feet projecting out of the body. Now, generally, when we say echinoderms, echinodermata literally means spiny or prickly skinned. So actually it is a Greek word which means echinos, which means hedgehog, and derma, it means skin. So the organisms which are similar to that of the hedgehog, their skin is prickly, their skin is not so smooth. So the name phylum was put forth by Jacob Kleene. Now Jacob Kleene is the man who coined the term Echinodermata in 1734, and he used this very term for the sea urchins. So earlier Echinodermata and coelenterates were included as a separate class among radiata because of their radial symmetry in the case of adults. So it is because of their radial symmetry they were placed in the radiata earlier, but later on they were put in the different phyla, that is Echinodermata. Echinodermata was first recognized as a group distinct from the radiata by Leucot. So Leucot was the first who recognized them as a separate group in 1847. Now what is that? Now Jacob Kleene coined the term in 1734 for sea urchins, but they were placed in radiata. But it was the Leucot in 1847 who recognized them as a separate group which is distinct from the radiata. And then when we talk about these very echinoderms or echinodermata, there are about 7,000 extant species, that is 7,000 living species are present in the case of the echinodermata. And they are the major group of deuterostome. Now these are the invertebrates, but they are deuterostomes. It means that the anus is formed first. The mouth is formed later on. So it is the deuterostoma. So when we talk about their general characters, though this is worth to mention, that they are exclusively marine. That is, now till date no freshwater species have been found. That it means they are exclusively marine. All are aquatic, and exclusively they are marine, and they are the most common widely distributed marine animals, and they are found in all the seas, whether intertidal zones to the great depths. So they are found from the intertidal zone to the greater depths, but generally they live in the sea bottom. They are pelagic and few are sessile. When we talk about the symmetry, they have a radial symmetry, and many organisms, such as in such a case, they do have the pentamerous radial symmetry, and they are having the pentamerous radial symmetry, while the larvae they are bilaterally symmetrical. So here in this very case, the larvae are bilaterally symmetrical, whereas the adults are radially symmetrical, and some are the pentamerous. This show the pentamerous symmetry. So when we say in that very case, this is said to be the bilateral symmetry, when we can divide in the organism into two equal halves, that is right and left. So this is the radial symmetry when they can be divided into two from any portion. So this is the radial symmetry here in this case, and this is the biradial symmetry when they are round in shape. So when we talk about the body, they are triploblastic, that is, they are made up of the three germ layers. They are coelomates, that is, they are having a coelom. So they are with distinct oral and aboral surfaces. Now, that very side where in the mouth is present, that very side is the oral side, and the opposite side we call it as the aboral side. That is, they have the two sides. One is the oral side and other is the aboral side. So they are the organism without definite head and segmentation. So without definite head, that is, head is missing or head is lacking in these very organisms. And they don't have the segmentation, that is, they don't have the segments in their body, that is, the segmentation is absent in these very organisms. So these are of moderate to considerable size, that is, it means they are bigger in size, they are somewhat large in size, and none of the organism is microscopic. It means they are of considerable size and none of the organism is microscopic. So when we talk about their body shape, they are rounded to cylindrical. So they are rounded in shape to cylindrical or star-like with simple arms radiating from a central disc, or branched feathery arms arise from us from a central body here in this very organism, that such as starfish. What you are seeing, that the arms do radiate from the main body or from the central disc. So when we talk about their surface of the body, so it is rarely smooth. So as the name suggests, that they are prickly skinned, it means their body is not smooth, it is rarely smooth. So typically it is covered by phyosymmetrically spaced radiating grooves called as ambulacra. So many times what we see, the spacing that is called as the ambulacra with phyo alternating interradii. Our interambulacra are seen in them. So what we are seeing in them as the ambulacra. So the spaces in between these very alternating ambulacra, we call them as the interradii or interambulacra. So presence of the water vascular system or the ambulacral system is the most characteristic feature. One of the important characteristic feature in them is the ambulacral system or the water vascular system. So it consists of the tubes filled with the watery fluids. So they are consisting of the tubes which are filled with the watery fluid. So when we talk about the endoskeleton, they consist of the closely fitted plates. So closely fitted plates, what we are seeing here in them, they are formed of the closely fitting plates forming a shell. So these form the endoskeleton plates in them. We call them as the theca or the test, forming a shell, which we call them as the theca or the test, which may be composed of separate small ossicles. So endoskeleton, it consists of the closely fitted plates forming a shell, usually called as theca or test, or it may be composed of the separate small. So when we talk about the coelom, this very coelom, it is spacious, lined by the peritoneum. So this is the peritoneum, this is the peritoneum, it is lined by the peritoneum, and it is mostly occupied by this very digestive system. This is the digestive system here, what we here see as the pyloric cecum, and these are the gonads here. So they are mostly occupied mainly by the digestive and the reproductive system, and dwells embryonic orchiandron, or we call them as the enterocoel. So when we talk about the coelom, it occurs from the embryonic orchiandron or enterocoel, and it is lined by the peritoneum and occupied mainly by the digestive and the reproductive systems. So when we talk about the body wall consists of an outer epidermis. So what we see, for example, this is an organism. What we see, it is the outer epidermis, and it is the middle is the dermis, and the inner lining, it is of the peritoneum. So when we talk about the body wall consists of an outer epidermis, a middle dermis, and the inner lining of the peritoneum. And then what we are seeing inside, it is the coelom. So the body wall consists of the outer epidermis, middle dermis, and the inner lining of the peritoneum. So when we talk about their digestive system, it is complete. But in some cases, it is incomplete digestive tract, such as in the case of brittle stars. In the case of brittle stars, that we found that the digestive system is not complete, it is incomplete. Mostly the digestive system is complete, but in some cases, it may be incomplete as well. And this very alimentary canal tract, what we call it as the alimentary canal, it is usually a quiet tube which extends from the mouth located on the oral surface to the anus, which is located on the aboral surface. So rightly from the, it extends from the mouth on the upper side to the anus on the lower side, or vice versa. So when we talk about their circulatory system, it is composed of an open type. And it is called as hemal system. So when we talk about the circulatory system, it is actually a hemal system. The blood has no pigment, so no pigment of the blood is found in them, and the heart is usually absent. Now, what we are seeing here, we are actually seeing the ring canals. Here in this case, what we are seeing that this is the ring canal, and what we actually see here that this is the oral canal. This is the oral canal, what we are seeing here. Now, I just want to tell you that what the hemal system comprises of. And then we do have a aboral ring canal. We do have the aboral ring canal here. This is the aboral ring canal here. And then we do have the vessels of the axial organ. We do have these very vessels of the axial organ. And we do have the radial canal. These are the radial canals. Then we do have the vessels of the intestine. So we do have here what we are seeing here, that these two have the vessels of the intestine here. Then the vessels of the sex gland are also present, such as here. In this very case, vessels of the sex gland are also present here. So what actually we are seeing here, the circulatory system, which is an open type and is called as the hemal system. Here the circulatory system is called hemal system. The blood has no pigment and the heart is absent. Now, talking about the respiratory organs, they include the dermal branchi, they include the tube feet, they include the respiratory tree and bursae. So actually the respiratory organs, they include the dermal branchi, tube feet, respiratory tree and bursae. So when we say that respiration occurs through variety of the structures, that is papulae in the case of starfishes, so we do have the papillae in the case of starfishes, then peristomial gills in the sea urchins, then we do have the genital bursae in the case of brittle stars, we do have the cloacal respiratory trees in the case of holothurians. So they are of different kinds and shapes. So I will be repeating again that such as papillae in the case of the starfishes, peristomial gills in the case of sea urchins, we do have the genital bursae in the case of brittle stars, and we do have the cloacal respiratory trees in the case of holothurians. Then when we talk about the excretory system is lacking, or excretory system, we say it is wanting. So it means there is no excretory system well defined. They are mostly monotelic. What ammonotelic? It means they excrete ammonia, and ammonia is usually lost by diffusion through the dermal branchia. So they usually lose the ammonia as an excretory byproduct or excretory product or the fecal matter, and they release it through the diffusion through the dermal branchia. When we talk about the nervous system, they are usually the organisms which are without breath. With circumoral ring, they do have the circumoral ring and the radial nerves. So these, they have the radial nerves and the circumoral rings. This is all what they have in the form of the nervous system. It means that they don't have a well-defined nervous system. Their nervous system is without a brain, just in the form of the circumoral ring and the radial nerves and the circumoral ring. So they do have the poorly developed sense organs, which includes the tactile organs, our chemoreceptors, our terminal tentacles, or what we say the photoreceptors, or the stratocysts. So their sense organs are poorly developed as well. So when we talk about the type of the sexes. So sexes are usually separate. Sexes are usually separate. It means they are dioecious, with few exceptions. Though certain exceptions are there. The gonads are simple or without simple ducts. It means they have a simple gonads are present. Reproduction usually is sexual. Few reproduce asexually. Mostly the reproduction is asexual, but few have the capability to reproduce asexually by the process of the regeneration. When we talk about the fertilization, it is usually one thing you should keep in mind, that most of the organisms which live in water and have abundant water, they have the external kind of the fertilization. Now the exceptions are there. But mostly in the case of echinoderms also, as they are exclusively aquatic and they are exclusively marine organisms, that is why they show the external fertilization. While some of the echinoderms, they show viviparity as well. When we say the development. The development is indeterminate. The development is indeterminate, and they include the characteristic larva, which undergoes metamorphosis into the radially symmetrical adults. So in the larva which are bilaterally symmetrical, they change into the radially symmetrical adults. Now when we talk about these very deuterostomes, these show intermediate development, in which each of the cells of the 8-cell embryo, if separated, they remain capable of the developing into a complete organism. So what do we mean by this very indeterminate kind of the development? So it means that when we say that the development is indeterminate, it means that the each cell of the 8-cell embryo is separated and it remains capable to develop into a complete organism. Whereas in the case of determinate development, the fate of each cell in the adult organism has already been determined. So in the case of indeterminate development, the cells, if separated, they can grow into a complete organism, whereas in the case of determinate development, it is not possible. So the fate has already taken place. They are bound to develop into the particular cells are bound to develop into the particular, you can say, organs or organ system. So in the case of indeterminate kind of the development, the each of the cells of the 8-cell embryo, if we separate them, they can grow into a complete organism. This is the indeterminate and determinate difference. So now talking about the unique features of the echinodermata. So when we talk about the unique features of echinodermata, they are spiny skin. The first important feature, spiny skin. Presence of water vascular system or the ambulacral system. This is again a unique feature. Hemal system, that is no circulatory system, but a hemal system is there. Then the tube feet, presence of the tube feet is also important characteristic feature, which is unique in the case of echinoderms. Then mesodermal endoskeleton of the calcareous plates. It is also unique character, that is the mesodermal endoskeleton. It is made up the calcareous plates. So bilateral symmetry in the case of larva and the pentamerous radial symmetry in the case of adults, it is also a unique feature. Then echinoderms occur only in the seawater. So it means they are exclusively marine. These are the unique characteristic feature of the echinoderms. Now, what are the degenerate characters? What these organisms have lost? So when we talk about their degenerate character, the head is lacking in them. The sense organs are very simple. They are not well developed. They should have been developed, but they are simple. So when we talk about the respiratory system, it is incomplete in some forms. Now it is complete in most, but it is also incomplete in some forms. Circulatory system is reduced, which is called as the Hemal system. Then the excretory system is also absent. So these are the degenerate characters which are found in the case of the echinoderms. Now they have certain resemblance with that of the chordates as well, such as radial and indeterminate cleavage. This is the character which resembles most to the chordates. Then the mouth is dried from the ectodermal invagination. So they are deuterostomes. As the higher organisms are deuterostomes, so they have the resemblance with that of the chordates as well. Then mesodermal endoskeleton, this is also a resemblance with the chordates. Then the anterior coelom, this is also a resemblance with the chordates. And the I was telling you about that the adult anus is derived from the adult anus is derived from the embryonic blastopore. So these are the resemblances which are seen in the case of the echinoderms. Now there are certain unique features in them. There are certain degenerative characters in them. Now they are the unique organisms which belong to the phylum Echinodermata, which usually means the spiny skinned organism. Thank you very much. Thank you for listening patiently, and I hope you like and subscribe BioLearnia. Press the bell icon and get the latest updates. Thank you very much.